This morning's Old Testament reading is taken from Psalm 20. May the Lord answer you when you are in distress. May the name of the God of Jacob protect you. May he send you help from the sanctuary and grant you support from Zion. May he remember all your sacrifices and accept your burnt offerings. May he give you the desire of your heart and make all your plans succeed. We will shout for joy when you are victorious, and we will lift up our banners in the name of our God. May the Lord grant all your requests. Now I know that the Lord saves his anointed. He answers them from his holy heaven and the saving power of his right hand. Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we trust the name of the Lord our God. They are brought to their knees and fall, but we rise up and stand firm. O Lord, save the King. Answer us when we call. May the Lord bless this reading.
Hey, Octavia, would you like to bring Aunt Kathy up here and have a story? You want to come? She's thinking about it. You sit here with me? And Kathy will be up there.
Can you see over the fuse?
Did you see somebody wave at you? Oh, okay. I don't know how much she can see. She's so tiny. Do you know how a flower grows?
No,
that's why we brought Aunt Kathy with us. Aunt Kathy, tell us how a flower grows.
Well, I'm pretty sure you have to start with a seed or a bulb, and you need to put it in the ground, and you need to water it. You should probably read the directions on where to put it, and then you have to hope and pray that it grows. Right, Bonnie?
Water and sun.
Is that how flowers come about?
Yeah. Well,
you all laugh at me, but I'm going to use my violets. How do you like that one? Pretty? Yeah? What color is it?
Purple.
Purple, and it matches your dress. Well, you know what? That didn't start out that big. You know how it got big? How are you going to get big?
It's
Asian
violet.
You what?
It's Asian
violet. It's an African violet.
It's an African violet?
She said eat eggs.
Okay.
No, she's not particularly because she eats good.
Yeah. So. Are you going to stay little all the time?
Oh, yeah.
No, you're not. When do you turn into a big girl? What age will you be?
Three.
3 years. She's 3 now.
You're 3 now, but when will you turn into a big girl? When you're 100?
Yeah.
How old's mommy? We'll get this one. How old's your mommy now?
I don't know.
How about Aunt Kathy?
I don't know.
You know what? You know the right answer to that.
Yep.
I want to show you how my African violet grows. Can you see what's in there?
Yeah.
What is that? It's a leaf. And you put the leaf in the soil, and look what happens. What are those little things?
Well, actually, they're little babies.
Yeah. And they're going to grow up to look like that. You think?
Maybe.
Depends on how lucky you are with them.
Sometimes, Octavia, what we want to happen doesn't happen. We can put the seeds in the ground, and sometimes it doesn't work out. And I can be a testimony that when we put leaves down like this, sometimes we get babies, and that's what those little things are. They're going to be little leaves, and sometimes it doesn't work. Right, Blanche?
Absolutely.
Yeah. So what are the things you think we need to do to make it happen? Okay, we need to start with the seeds, but they need, what do they need to eat? Water, and sun, and good soil, and what do you need to grow up?
Food.
Food that you don't like. What kinds of food are you going to eat?
Tomatoes and apples.
That's the two things she'll eat, right?
Yeah, she does eat a lot of fruit.
Good for you. So that means that when you get a little older, you're going to grow up, that you're not going to stay like a little girl. You're going to be a big girl. Is that something good?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So continue to eat your good food, and you'll grow up to be a big girl. Okay? Just like my plants, if they get the right food, they might, in the future, look like this. Oh, she doesn't have an apple today? Gigi or Aunt Kathy will get an apple for you, okay? Okay. Go back and sit with Gigi. Thank you, Aunt Kathy.
Our Heavenly Father, we are truly grateful that we can come into this, your house, and worship you once again. We pray, O God, that you would forever open our hearts and our minds so that your word would be heard and we would be changed. This day, O God, we pray for those that are still sick. We pray for healing for Claire as she gains her strength once again. And we pray, O God, that as they get the results of her test, they would come up with a way to make her feel better. We pray for a friend, Diana Cook, who had a fall in the bathtub and, Lord, is now in the hospital. Lord, we pray that her healing would also come, that they would come with the right treatment and that she would be healed completely. We pray for families suffering with financial issues. Lord, you know each and every one, and many times, oh God, they are not obvious. But Lord, we pray for you to speak into their lives and to give them guidance and discernment as they deal with these issues so that they can move forward. Lord, we also pray for those that are looking to sell their homes and to buy homes. Lord, what a crazy market it is now. So many people have been disappointed and let down. Lord, we just pray that you would speak into those situations as well, that you, O God, would lend truth and that you all the dealings would be fair and just. Lord, continue to show your presence to families who are suffering with all kinds of issues. We pray for safe travel for Bonnie as she is in North Carolina. Lord, we just thank you that she is able to be away and to enjoy time with her friends, Lord, a time that has been healing for her since she lost her husband. Lord, we thank you for the day we had yesterday, so for John's interment. Lord, what a joy it was to be together with families. And Lord, we pray that you would speak into them as well, into the youth who don't have complete understanding, Lord, but seem to just get a glimpse of what life is about. So Lord, we pray that you give them knowledge as they mature as well. We thank you that it was a safe day for all. And Lord, we pray for Maggie, a newcomer to our community, Lord, who has lost her husband as well. Lord, that you be able to give her strength and guidance, Lord, that she be encouraged that she can do this. Lord, so many times we question our abilities when only we need to look to you and we would gain that strength. Now, God, we pray for our hymn sing this evening, Lord, that you would gather the people together outside, Lord, that they would be able to sing joyously to you and to have fellowship with one another once again. We thank you for each and every blessing, Lord, and pray this day that you would continue to bless us as your disciples. For we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning our gospel lesson comes from Mark chapter 4, verses 26 through 34. Two very familiar parables that Jesus spoke in an attempt to help the disciples and others understand the kingdom of God. Hear now as Jesus speaks. Jesus said, "This is what the kingdom of God is like. A man scatters seed on the ground. Night and day, whether he sleeps or gets up, the seed sprouts and grows, though he does not know how. All by itself, the soil produces a grain, first the stalk, then the head, then the full kernel in the head. As soon as the grain is ripe, he puts the sickle to it, because the harvest has come." Again, Jesus said, "What shall we say the kingdom of God is like, or what parable shall we use to describe it? It is like a mustard seed, which is the smallest seed you plant in the ground. Yet when planted, it grows and becomes the largest of all garden plants, with such big branches that the birds of the air can perch in its shade." With many similar parables, Jesus spoke the word to them as much as they could understand. He did not say anything to them without using a parable, but when he was alone with his own disciples, he explained everything. May we too have understanding this morning as we look to these parables. Once again, Jesus is using symbolic language to teach. Maybe we would understand, maybe not. But you will remember that the parables were just one of the literary forms that Jesus used to teach the people. Most times, he would not explain what it meant to the crowds. But as scripture says, then in private, he would explain it more to his disciples. That's one of the things that I love, and I know others hate, about scripture. It makes you think. See, people want it, just tell me the rules, right? But that's not how Jesus teaches. He makes us think about what he is saying. It's not easy sometimes to understand it. But when scripture continues to fall on our ears, and as we continue to age, we grow more understanding. As mature Christians, our understanding should have grown more than it was when we were children. I hope that's the way it is anyway. Jesus was speaking about the kingdom of God, and these descriptions are among the easiest to understand. What is so small turns into something that bears much fruit. And in the first parable, he makes it clear that we only have a very small part to play, and then there is that miraculous that happens, and that's where he comes in. We just never know when the things we do will have an impact on others. Most of the time, it is in the small, unintentional things that have the biggest impact. Sometimes the grand gestures, as seen, as being loaded with ulterior motives, and sometimes not good ones. Yet the small gestures are not seen as having hidden meanings. All of you who have read our first book for this summer should understand that in a new way. And that's one of the things that we're going to talk about. These minuscule acts lead to miraculous works of God. Jesus uses the seed to illustrate this. For as farmers, it could be understood. They knew what it took to grow crops. To take a small seed and plant it and then water it and wait and wait and wait. Well, it takes a miracle of God for it to grow. We can't see what's going on in the soil. We just have to have patience. Good luck with that. And faith that it will grow. Sometimes it does. Sometimes it doesn't. But despite all of it, we can't give up. If it is meant to grow and produce, God definitely has a mighty role to play. Now, I know that in New Jersey, most of us plant something, whether it's flowers or vegetables or whatever kind of plants. Not all of us use seed. So who uses seed? Rich? A couple people use seed? And Octavia, of course, there she goes. Some of us use seed. Some of us have given up on seed and depend on the nursery, right? We go and buy the plants. I confess, that's what I did. I always kill tomato plants, and this year I said, I'm doing one. We'll see if it survives. And yes, it's getting banana juice, so don't worry, we'll see what happens. But sometimes, even when we buy plants from the nursery, they don't always grow. We can blame it on the plant. We can blame it on the nursery. But guess what? We're usually the guilty ones. Whether we didn't water it enough, or we watered it too much, or we planted it where it didn't belong, or we tried to force it to produce by giving it chemicals and we killed it, we're guilty, even if we don't want to admit it. Now, a little more about me and my violets. To start a beautiful plant like this, and this is the baby plant, the bigger one's in my office too, I don't start with seed. I'm not that good of a grower. But what we start with is a leaf. One leaf planted in the soil. And if we're lucky and put a little bit of water in it, and then we give it a cozy little home. We put it in a bag, close the bag, give it a little bit of air, or coffee breath. And the trick is we have to leave it alone and have faith. Sometimes when we're too ambitious, when we want it to grow faster, we try to do different things to it. Or we may take it out of the bag too soon and it'll die. Or we leave it in the bag too long and it will die. But the reward is the little plantlets, the little leaves that come up. This one has, I think, like four or five, but they're tiny, so they're too small to come out of the bag yet. But can you believe that something that starts out like this turns into this? Now, Blanche is a good grower. She knows it can happen. But that takes faith, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. Talk about patience. Oh, my. You can't rush African violets. And when I run out of patience, and when I don't do what I'm supposed to do, and they fall over and play dead, I have to start all over again. But it's not the plant's fault. Whose fault is it? It's my fault. The same goes for planting seeds of faith. Many times God does his part, but then we don't do what is needed so that the fruit will flourish. God gives us plenty of opportunities to spread the news of Jesus Christ, but we have a habit of falling short when we are called into action. We're great at procrastinating, putting it off until, you name the excuse, we have them all. My friends, kingdom work is never done. It is something that should be second nature to all believers so that the kingdom can grow in numbers. Now, I'm not talking about grand gestures. I'm still talking about how small acts of kindness can grow into something much bigger. I believe that we have learned that cramming scripture down someone's throat just chokes them. It truly does more harm than good. And the chances of them ever tasting the sweet words of God is almost nil when that happens. Yet small acts of kindness, a helping hand, a few kind words, that is where the miraculous has a chance to take hold. And again, unless God is in the plan, nothing can happen. Yet we will never know just when that will happen. It may happen quickly. I love to see leaves go into babies real quick. Sometimes it takes days. Sometimes it takes weeks. Sometimes it even takes years before we see the product of what we have done. But you never know when you have touched another person's life. And I hate to say this, but sometimes just one negative encounter can detract from that goal. As we witness all the abuse that has taken place involving children and priests, it's easy to see why so many have turned from the church. But once again, the actions of others should not stop us from doing the right thing, from doing what God calls us to do. We are all kingdom workers. See, you all thought you were retired already, didn't you? We are all kingdom workers, given the task to spread the good news of the saving grace of Jesus Christ. We just need to learn how to do it. From minuscule, miraculous, and mighty, that is the work of our God. Amen. Let us make sure that we have enough space for God to do the miraculous. Let us do our small part so that the miraculous can happen. Spread the good news of Jesus Christ and see the fruit that it will produce. Go in God's peace. Amen.